Okay, let's chat about error handling, and in particular, how to improve the maturity of your error handling techniques over time as you work with the Rust programming language. My name is Tim, and here's the agenda for our session together. First, we're going to be defining what an error actually means, both from your view as a programmer as well as the type system's view of what an error is. I want to spend a little bit of time talking about the results type in Rust and how result often wraps a some other type T, what that actually means. And then I want to kind of progress through multiple levels of maturity for defining errors in a way that's reusable for you and hopefully for your users as well. But first, I want to kind of explain a story about how I learned Rust. And I started out playing with things like this. So I was like, okay, I want to learn about, let's say, printing to the screen. And I was playing around with variables. So here I've got a mutable variable out that I write to. And that's kind of fine and good. I figured out that you needed to import a trait in order for you to have access to things. And but it turned out that there was still a problem. I would get this compile error. This returns a result which may be an error variant which should be handled. I was like, oh, okay, that seems weird. What do I do? Well, I ignored the problem. Right away, I just thought, look, I can just make it vanish. I can make that error go away. And like things would just print out. My Hello Tim message would come through and that would be fine. I then discovered that you could actually return a result from main. And with the help of the question mark operator, this didn't seem very much different than what I had before. I could say that I could just bubble up the error to main. I needed this weird thing at the bottom though, okay unit. So the inner brackets or inner parentheses are called the unit type, and this is the okay variant of result. The word variant comes from enum. Enums in Rust have variants that you can be, and the result can have one of two. It turns out, though, that there are multiple different results in the standard library, and this causes a problem later on. So if I move forward, I've got a when I wanted to start learning, here's a more complicated example, and I'm returning a different results type. So in this instance, I'm actually writing my Hello Tim message to a file in stored in temp hello txt. And the question mark operator does something different. It returns a stud IO result of unit back from the right macros and print and from these stud fs calls, like for example writing and reading from a string. And that seemed like it was okay and everything was fine, and I got into this other problem where I would try and combine error types. So if we look at the kind of the body, or essentially focus on what we really want is to be able to create some sort of return type that represents both errors. Because the problem that we faced, or I started facing earlier on, is that stud IO result is not stud format result. And like everything started to get really, really complicated when I wanted to combine or multiplex error types. So here is your magical way out. It turns out that you can use a trait object. And this was kind of my learning journey. And your box dyn stud error error says, this is a more complicated error type, more complicated return type. I need to, I've still got my unit on the left, but on the right, I'm also defining an error. I'm no longer prefixing my results type with stud IO or stud FS because I'm actually using something that is implicit, which is the stud result, this result type is a third result. this one here is defined within the standard result module. And it is included in every Rust program by default. The reason why I need to use a new one is that on the third line down, or third line from the bottom, this contents trim.parse method tries to interpret whatever it's reading or the string it is, the parse method and is trying to interpret some string as a number and cast it as or convert it to an integer. And this returns an error that is generated, which is I think parse int error, which is not anything to do with the file system. And so this error that's returned in the third line down is different than errors that are generated from the file system. And so what we get is a system where the question mark operator applies a conversion from whichever concrete error type you have into some dynamic trait object. Now this is really, really helpful because it means that essentially you can pretend like custom error types don't exist. And that for me was a kind of a mind-bending experience as I was learning the language, moving from just playing around, getting into real trouble with errors and results and OKs and units and a whole bunch of other stuff, and becoming more familiar with some of the other mechanisms, which can really make Rust feel almost like a dynamic language. Okay, so we just had my diversion. Let's go back to the agenda. And now we want to have our two attempts at describing what an error is. And first of all, we need the sort of the programmer's view of an error. Now, a program might think of an error as something that doesn't normally happen. So we have our, and we might use the term edge case or exception, whereby an error is something that is not planned for, and you know it might happen, but it probably won't. We can also think of an error as something that is a marker that we need to provide hints for debugging later. It's essentially a marker that a problem has occurred, and you should actually provide some useful output so that you can indicate that a problem has happened for anyone that wants to investigate something later. Lastly, there is this notion that an error might be something completely unexpected. So the first two, we might encounter, our program might encounter some sort of state that was completely unanticipated. And the typical outcome here is that the whole program crashes. And this in Rust's world is called panicking. The type system, in some sense, is a much simpler view of what an error is. Rust's type system, in particular, just treats errors as values. They are not special in any way. The only thing that denotes something as being an error is that it implements a trait, stud error error. So that is the standard library marker, the error module inside that, and within that module is a trait error. And it turns out that everything that implements display automatically will have an implementation of error defined for it. And so the display trait or stud error, sorry, I've written there stud error display, but it's actually I believe stud format display. So sorry for the wrong module. But the display trait is implemented for all types where we expect that end users will be able to see the message, if that makes any sense. It's slightly distinct from the debug trait, which can be automatically derived. The display trait needs to be implemented manually, which has a slight advantage in the sense that we can, if I go back here, we can actually implement display and then use that automatically as an error type. And that will come in handy later when we want to use string. Now, I think it might be kind of useful to explain a little bit about what a result is. It turns out that the result is just an enum. And allow me to sort of flesh that out in slightly more detail. I'm going to bring up a web browser and we will go to Rust's standard library. And if I go to Rust and then go search for result, duck duck go will go for result. And it turns out that it's literally just, if I look in the source code and then hunt for result. Oh, there is a module that it might want me to go into. I wonder if I can find it. Here it is. So it's actually an enum with a couple of extra annotations, but the core of it is just okay and error. And these extra annotations are useful for the documentation and actually the compiler, these lang items as well. Let's kind of ignore that. But it is literally just a type. And the thing that is interesting is that it... so we also have some extra annotations around must use, for example, which is where the error message comes out. And the thing that's interesting is that results implement errors. Sorry. No. Have errors, which and what is an error? An error is something which determines which can be used as a can be printed out to the screen. Ugh, gosh, that was kind of a horrible explanation, but hopefully you'll bear with me. You'll notice that result has two generic parameters, T and E. And you'll also remember that one of the earlier text examples I had was from there was standard IO error and standard format error, and they were different. What on earth was going on there? It turns out that it's very common for individual modules to describe or sort of define their own error types. And the reason why this becomes so, this is again, they are just values, and in fact in this case they are structs. So but the thing that makes them useful is that they implement another trait. And in this case, where they implement display, which means in a roundabout way, the error types that are defined with inside these individual modules, in this case stud format, implement display, and there is and the compiler knows how to treat anything that implements display as an error trait. So we kind of we've overloaded the name here, and I think that's one of the most confusing things. That result is scattered all over the show. If I look in the Rust documentation, I'll see result like 30 different types of result that are not able to be used in the same way. And error is the same. This is a convention in the Rust community to actually define, to essentially overload the names, prevents stuttering. But I know that a lot of people who might have come from Java would prefer that that the namespacing wasn't so aggressive. Anyway, that's just a sort of something by the by. Now, where was I? I wanted to talk a little bit more about maturity of error handling, in particular, how we could start out by just ignoring results. And let's bring up the code. So this is some of the code from earlier before. You can see here that here's our hello txt. And I'm returning this trait object, which happens to implement this error trait, which I described before. Now, this works fine. And I'm going to copy it so that I could refer to it later. But I'm going to ignore all of this and just try and see how far I can get by essentially ignoring everything. The conventional way to ignore everything is to unwrap. Now, unwrap is a bit of a strange word when it comes to errors. And the way to think of it is, in fact, there was at one stage, by the way, just as trivia, a proposal to call this assert. But unwrap will, if you think about the fact that results have two variants, the unwrap essentially says, take whatever's inside and give me what the result is containing. Okay, so we have a bunch of problems. Here we are actually returning results. So I'll just get that going. And actually, this works fine. So this is going to sound a very, very odd thing to say for someone who cares about type systems. But if unwrap is what gets you to a working program, it might actually be a valid way for you to proceed. I'm not saying that it's useful in every single circumstance, but I'm saying that for like something that feels like a one-off script, it might actually be something that's worthwhile to actually experiment with. You know, we can do things that are slightly better. We can expect and provide an error message and just say, unable to create file. You know, this is kind of one step above. And the same thing here, we could say, you know, for all of these, you know, maybe the file has been deleted since we since we actually tried to create it, and I could go even further, and I'll create a format message. At this point, though, once you're using expect, there is actually something maybe that you could think of doing, which is using some of the error functionality available to you. So I'm just going to cause another problem. So we've actually got quite far just by sort of ignoring the errors. An alternative way to do this is that In this case here, in on line 9, we can also tell when we don't care about either the OK value or the error value, you can just assign to, or just bind the underscore to the output. So the write line macro, for example, returns a result that returns a unit. So it's kind of a slightly cleaner way to go, because unwrap does feel a bit crazy. It feels dangerous. And the reason why it feels dangerous is what we're going to see right now, because on line 15, we are unwrapping something which cannot be interpreted as an integer. In fact, I'll just make it super clear. Let's say that I'm saying hello. We get a panic. And in fact, it's saying parse int error kind. It's an invalid digit. And that's a problem. You don't want your error, you don't want your users to encounter things like this. So what are our options? Well, we've talked about expect. We can add extra messages. Here's an alternative. If we map an error, we could so we've got a parse int error. I'll just call it parse error. We could essentially translate it to something else. We can kind of transform that into, we could have our own error type, and we could just say unit. We could define it. We'll just have our own error type just for now. And then say if let okay answer. And then I wonder what will happen now. The code is looking quite ugly because of the size. I'm just going to remove this one. And I want an else block. So now I can do move print answer into there, else now I can say eprint line help. I wonder if this is going to work. Probably not. It's saying that it doesn't actually know what error type this is, because we don't have an error defined in our code. So I might, we can't actually access, we could try. No, it's not going to be super happy with us, because we haven't actually defined a whole error type, which is kind of nuts. But because we are not returning our own error up here, the type inference mechanisms aren't able to really handle this idea of taking some external error and wrapping and like adjusting it for ourselves. So I would like to encourage you, however, to play around with some of the options as we do get more mature, and like as the maturity levels start to increase, you can do some conversion by yourself. But we wanted to say that our first level of maturity was actually being able to ignore the error completely. Aha, so now is our number 2. Now, what do I mean by that? What I mean is that instead of actually having an error type, we could actually just use string. Or if you would prefer, you can use, if you've got fixed messages, you could return even are static. String slices that are bound to the static lifetime. So in this case, I wonder if it will still. And we now have a whole bunch of errors from the compiler saying that the question mark operator will no longer work. The I wonder if I will now be able to do what I wanted to do before, which is actually adjust . So this is I'm just going to comment out a bunch of the other error problems. And what we're trying to do is take any sort of other error and turn it into our own one. Except the... Again, the type inference friends are not being as nice to us as what we want. I'm going to create another function, which is to display a string. So I've got some input text here, and I've got a string slice. And for some reason, I want to return a result. And that result is going to have just an OK, or sort of a unit, which I can kind of use as a sentinel value, and then some string of an error. And let's say for whatever reason, if the text starts with question mark, and like if it starts with a question mark, then we had some, for some reason it's an invalid string, and then I can return then I can return a string and invalid. Otherwise, I can return OK here, and then I will print out the text. This is actually another, and over here, I'll just do all of this as well. For whatever reason, I'm printing out the path. I'm displaying my path. And it returns a result. So again, I want to use the question mark operator. And one of the interesting things of what I've done is that because I've got two result types, I've got a string here and I've got a static string here, they don't know how I'm not able to, the type system doesn't automatically know how to convert one to the other. And so I can actually repeat the type, and hopefully things will work. Okay, I can print out my path, which is helpful. So the reason why I think that it can actually be a relatively valid thing to do, defining a result that has defining a result with string, is that it can kind of be it can enable you to get through the bureaucracy. It can be really tedious to do what I'm about to suggest. So if I've got multiple different types of errors. I've got some traits that I don't need. I can, actually, that's interesting. How long? Oh, I don't actually, so this, it's actually, I was going to say, it's not printing anything on the second one, and that's because the, I don't actually do anything with the result. So that's one of the problems, one of the reasons why Rust always asks you to actually use the output. Ah, okay. That's interesting. Expected something over here. Ah, I need iflet. Okay, so it's 14 bytes characters, 14 characters long. And but we're really talking about results here. And so if our error types are, you know, if we're just working for ourselves, we're not actually building a production library or we're just experimenting, we can use essentially just strings with arbitrary output for our error messages. But there is a big but, and the big but is that it's we essentially ignore all of the type system. And if I go back to my code, a significantly better way to do this is to actually define some custom error type, which can, and remember that this is defined with inside the context of your code. And so the Rust convention is that it's actually okay to reuse the term error and overload that term, even though it's kind of annoying if you are trying to decide between different types of errors. So now I'm going to return my error type here, and let's say I can no longer return strings. So oops. But let's say that if the length is less than 2, I have an error and it's too short. Or else if len is greater than 50 or 100, and then it's too long. Otherwise, I can just return the OK value of the length. So I've kind of got this validation step as well. And why is that unhappy? It's saying that we expected it to... Ah, I don't need this one here. Now, I've got two different types of errors here, and this one no longer returns a... Actually, it's kind of still the same because we are dealing with this manually. We haven't worried about the the error type. If I go back to the question mark operator, once I've created multiple things, I'm going to have the compiler give me a problem. And so in my code, I can either do two different things. One is I can define an error for every single possible error that my code might actually generate. And so my error type might become 50 lines long. Otherwise, I can be slightly more fine-grained depending on whether or not I have something that relates to user input versus something that might relate to the file system permissions, or and essentially group the different types of errors along to provide some more context. But this can become very unwieldy over time. And it might be an idea to... But let's kind of go a it might be an idea to spend a little bit of thinking, or like a little bit of mental energy, on exactly where the balance should be. Because the problem that you'll face very quickly is that, and I'm just going to say invalid, and I will and so now the question mark operator will act. Oh, if I return my error type, and now the question mark operator should actually work happily, because both of my functions now implement the same thing, and they know how to convert themselves to, let's say, if I wanted to say convert themselves, they don't know how to convert themselves into string, which is why the error was created. But as soon as the type system is happy, we can do things more. As soon as the type system is happy, the code compiles. You might be wondering, why on earth have I bothered with all of this of defining a custom error type? Well, and it really doesn't pay off if you're just writing little scripts. But it can get much better when you are defining it can get much, much better when you are trying to have specific actions that are related to the type of errors that you create. We know that sometimes we might have permissions errors, and therefore we could ask the user to check the file system. But if the or we want to provide a more specific error message if there was some sort of data corruption, or the input was out. So now I've got, I need to be able to, we can actually match on all of our variants individually and do things that are different. Depending, so if it's too short, we might want a different path. Let's say that it's too short. One of the things that we could do is actually go and duplicate the text. Instead of returning an error, we can display path. Well, we could create some other string, like a string that we knew there was. So we had too short, and one of the things we would like to do is we've got our temporary string with capacity, say 100, and then we extend it to grow, and then we do it again. Oh, I'm getting a whole bunch of ugly error messages from the, and now I'm actually going to print temp again, and if this doesn't work this time, well, it's just going to give up. And likewise with too long, I could just do something different, which is I could try and display the path, and but only the first, say, 20 characters. Let's say, and I just I can oh what is this? I've still got another another warning about about future errors, and that's because these second calls to display that are dealt with from my text are what are they? They actually generate their own errors, their own results. Now, it turns out that I still have panics, which is not exactly what I wanted. Because it, let's say less than two. Oh, okay. Okay, well, finally, apparently the compiler knows about how to do this. I get T. And that's fine. I should stop playing around. The reason why you... So the question that you may be asking is like, why on earth would you bother with defining an enum when you can actually match on string anyway? And the reason why that is that you can provide these exhaustiveness checks. If you were to just return string as an error, like we were originally, and then in your match statements, try to essentially determine what the actual error was, you end up creating these miniature parsers, and this can become quite brittle. Okay, let's kind of move back to the slides. The last thing that we could do is actually use, like, we had a whole bunch of bureaucracy involved with that, with kind of getting everything up. It turns out that there is a simpler way. In particular, you can use the crate called this error, which will take care of a lot of the bureaucracy related to actually defining a custom enum for your type. And I'm going to show you just a very brief hint about what the documentation looks like, just so you can get a feel for what it is that I mean. Just a second. So here is the website. And you can see I've got, this is an example, I pull in my this error error type, and here's my enum, and I can have custom error messages and say that actually this originated out of another type of error. So I can return data store error and give it the disconnect enum if it was generated from, and it would have originally come from, a stat IO error. There might be some sort of reason to redact values. Possibly we're trying to hide secrets. There might be some data that we're no longer wanting to return, and therefore, and this is just a good demonstration of being able to actually provide a format string inside as well. And it just provides a whole bunch of simplicity to getting things going. Now, it turns out, though, that that's not the only approach that you can take. You could actually return these trait objects as well. And there are two crates that I really want to point you to. There is the anyhow crate, which is also, which kind of stays relatively close to just defining trait objects yourself. Whereas the ear crate, after Jane Eyre, the creator of the crate, the spelling is a bit different, but it's quite neat as well. Ear provides your code, your you, the ability to find this a report, and you have extensive error reporting as part of it. So I strongly recommend that you play with that one as well. And we're getting very close to the end. I wanted to point you to a couple of extra resources. I hope that you enjoyed the stream or the recording, depending on which you followed. There is lots more to this topic. The best way to go from here is to really try it. And so I encourage you to do so. Hopefully you've had some resources and some tips and trade. Actually, what I really wanted from right now is to give you the confidence to say that it's okay to learn. It's okay to use string if you need to. It's actually just fine to start small. You will find yourself reaching for tools that provide significantly more robustness over time. However, right now, if you're a learner, the emphasis really needs to be on keeping things cognitively low. And I hope that showing you that you can use string, that you could even ignore the possibilities of errors occurring, is actually a valid path, or are actually valid paths forward in certain circumstances. If you're writing small utilities and things for yourself and you're learning Rust, try to avoid being, try to avoid learning everything at once. Give yourself the time to put in a to-do. We need to do proper errors for this. With that, I shall leave you alone. And I hope you've enjoyed the lesson here. Okay, cheers. Bye-bye.